Welcome, FIDE President Arkady Dvorkovich, to what we are now calling Hard Talk. I don't know if we're going to have many more episodes of this. Maybe it's the start of a series, who knows. But we thought it was a good idea to talk to you, especially about everything that happened around the online Olympiad. So, yeah, thank you for coming and welcome here.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, and I'll be happy to answer your questions.
So yeah, it was a long and big event, 1,500 participants or actually more. But in the end, especially the playoff series, there were some unfortunate situations with disconnections. It's not the best finish of a tournament like that. So in general, how do you feel? How do you look back at it?
Well, let me start with saying that the whole idea of the online Olympiad came to our mind about 4 months ago when we started thinking about all kinds of online activities to fill the gap that was created by pandemic. We had junior event organized by our Chinese friends. Then we had the online Nations Cup with just a few teams participating. And then that, when it was clear that we are not going to have a real Olympiad this year in Russia, we started thinking about the online Olympiad. And I'm happy that we had more than 160 teams participating. So the vast majority of FIDE members competed for both the success, but also the Olympiad is about festivities. The Olympiad is about enjoying playing, meeting friends, this time online, but still it was good. Also, we had a few innovations, most importantly, the mixed character of teams with six boards, two men, two ladies, one junior boy, one junior girl, and substitutes for all of them. And each board is equally important. That is what mattered, actually. I and my team wanted everyone to feel responsible for the team's result. So not just the best player, but also a player, the last board, was equally important and responsible for the result of the team. Of course, we envisaged the difficulties. We knew that we are going to have issues with internet connection in many places, and we knew that we are going to have issues with cheating, since we are talking about online. Happily, we identified only 8 cases of likely cheating, I would put it this way, over the course of the Olympiad, which is almost zero, I would say. It's slightly more than zero.
The number of players and the number of games.
Exactly. So yeah. Exactly. Cheating exists, and it's still a big problem for online chess and for chess in general. Mm-hmm. But at this Olympiad, it was not a widespread thing. Internet quality has been a problem throughout the Olympiad, starting from the very first division, and especially in the base division and the first division, since countries playing in those divisions were the countries with poorer economic conditions, with the quality of infrastructure not sufficient to provide a high-speed internet connection all the time. So we are talking about Africa in particular, unfortunately. We are talking about some of the countries in Oceania, in Eastern Asia, some South American countries. And in some countries, the outages of internet have been related to the political events, especially the Somalia case.
Remember Somalia,
yeah. Exactly. They couldn't participate starting from the second day already of the complete blockage of internet due to the political events. There was a risk of the same happening with Belarus, but yes. Again, happily, one day before they decided to switch it on, and Belarus team was able to participate. We had two major issues during the playoff stage. The first
yeah,
one.
Let Let's start about that later, because you were also mentioning, I wanted to start with that, the diversity in this Tour Olympiad with two general boards, two women boards, and two under 20 boards. From the diversity standpoint, this is very positive, and we got to see a lot of new names and promising upcoming players also. But at the same time, this was also criticized because we were not seeing the best teams of each country. And in sports in general, fans like to see the very best teams competing against the very best teams. So how do you look back at this decision to make teams like this?
I still believe it was the right decision, since people from the same country should feel the one team, independent on the age and gender. Of course, there are some pluses in having separate teams, since you can have more higher rated players involved. But I think it was exciting to see men and ladies in one team, and juniors as well, who for them it was a huge experience as well. It was the check whether they're able already to compete at the highest possible level, since they were competing not just for themselves, not just for their own success, but for the success of the team. So they had to play a bit differently from how they play usually against their against guys from the same age group, in a more responsible manner. I would say, well, first of all, we had best players in most of the teams, since you still had two players plus two substitutes. So in most teams, like Russian and Indian team, who were in the final, all four best players have...
Yeah, but they could never play at the same time, of course.
Yes, but still people knew that they could see their best players at some point. Was another important thing. We are talking about countries, and we are talking about how countries should develop chess, that they should focus on the things they are weak at, not only on the things they are strong at. Yes, for some teams, to add ladies to the team was weakening the team, but for some countries, adding ladies was strengthening of the team. Mm-hmm. I would mention Ukraine, Georgia, Kazakhstan, where ladies are very strong, actually. When you add them, it's good for the teams. They can compete more equal manner. Also, adding juniors in some cases was strengthening of the teams. In some countries, there are very good aged players, but they didn't put enough attention to raising new generation of players. And that's why they were losing. I think that just a reminder to all chess federations that they should pay attention to all aspects of the development of chess, not just to their best players. I think it's one of the functions of the Olympiad to do this.
Would you even consider introducing this next year as well?
I'm not sure. We will discuss the experience. We'll discuss the lessons of this Olympiad. There are a couple of more innovations, of course. First is a division by groups from weaker to stronger. There are many advocates of this structure. Many people believe that we should do the same at the main Olympiad, but there are also minuses, negative sides of that, since weaker teams want to face the strongest teams.
First couple of rounds. If you're board one player of a weaker country, it's an amazing opportunity to have a chance to play against Carlson, of course.
Exactly. So maybe we should think about some kind of a mix that would allow us still to have a couple of rounds playing against strong teams, but then to find a way for strong teams to compete between themselves to identify the winner. Sometimes not good that the winner is identified by additional coefficients and that are determined by the level of play or of other teams, not of the teams themselves.
Yeah. So,
and another thing was a tiebreak rule, the Armageddon rule, that was also controversial, but really exciting for spectators. Sometimes for teams it was
but didn't
huge stress, but for spectators it was exciting.
Wasn't it a little bit too random?
I think it was random, yes. Again, we were trying to weigh two things, the excitement of spectators and the fair approach. I personally thought that maybe a couple of blitz games would be good before Armageddon.
Right.
And if blitz games are not decisive, then Armageddon could come in effect. But other players thought that, in the end, it created the huge excitement of spectators. So we will think about the future, whether we should use the same or we should change the format. But certainly those innovations were really interesting. And some of those could be used in traditional chess, but probably not all of those.
Yeah, and all of these differences, like the Armageddon, making it random, and also, especially teams not being able to come up with their six strongest players, which is more, you could say, in the Olympic spirit. When you have the Olympics, countries are basically sending their best athletes everywhere in all the sports. So a lot of times I heard that this tournament should not have been called an Olympiad. And unfortunately, the Online Nations Cup was a name that was not available because we already used it. But yeah, many people thought, okay, it's fine to organize this, but don't call it an Olympiad.
The name is not FIDE Chess Olympiad. The name is FIDE Chess Online Olympiad.
Yes.
So the name is different. I don't think we should consider the two Olympiads is completely the same, put in the same line. I think the Online Olympiad is really important. It's a big event, but it's just not the same.
Mm-hmm.
We should all understand that.
Okay. Well, I think it's time to dive into the more details about the actual last decision, the big decision you had to make. I have a lot of questions about that. Questions that partly are also coming from the community via Twitter and in comments on their articles. So going into it very specifically, we can start by saying that the Russian team members they were not happy about it, and some of them pointed out that on the top four boards, Russia won this second match 2.5-1.5. Because of Alexander Goryachkina's victory against Humpy Conero. But at the same time, Humpy actually also lost her internet connection for a while, and she lost precious time getting back, but she did manage to get back in time into the game, and then she lost. And then there were the boards of Nihal Sarin and Deshmukh, and Sarin was in an equal position, and Deshmukh, the Indian player, was objectively winning, but both were in time trouble. But at the same time, the final decision, you could say that the first match ended in 3-3. And you could say that because of that, the second match was sort of decided that it was also ending in 3-3. So purely based on playing situation, time and board, do you think it was a fair decision like that?
Well, first of all, if I would not say it's a fair decision, I would not take it. Since fairness was one of the most important considerations in the decision-making process this time, besides the legal aspects of legal and technical aspects of the situation. So there are three components, legal, technical, and fairness. No politics whatsoever. Let me stress this from the very beginning, since we are being accused doing this from political considerations. Only three things were important to me when I was taking the decision. The second thing that is important to understand that this final was preceded by another case in the quarterfinal between India and Armenia. And to understand the logic of the second decision, you need to understand the logic of the first, since people compare it, especially our friends in Armenia compare the two decisions, and of course some members of the Russian team as well. In that particular case, I was serving as a member of the appeals committee, and when the situation happened in the game of Hayek Martirosyan against, I think it was also Sarin, right?
I think so, yeah.
Nihal Sarin, and Hayek had 52 seconds on his clock in the position that was, I would say, as equal as the position of Sarin in the game against Russia. So objectively equal, but we all know that how difficult it is to defend equal positions when you have just a few seconds on your clock. So
yeah, I actually noticed that in the very final position, the black player actually had to be a little bit careful and had to actually protect his e6 pawn, otherwise they would have been winning.
Well, this night before, yes, we all know the right move, but yes, when you have just a few seconds on the clock, well, you could make a mistake. So certainly I was not the one to evaluate the positions. I'm not a grandmaster, and I should not do it, and I cannot even take it into account. Of course, I could not avoid thinking about that, but it was not a major factor. So in the case of Armenia, we started looking into the technical aspects of the situation and found that there is no global issue, no issue on the side of chess.com, as we have been confirmed by the technical team of chess.com. And at the same time, regulations...
By the way, the Armenians want to see this information.
Yes, and we are still expecting the report, full report from chess.com on that.
As I understand right now, chess.com is where I must say disclaimer, of course, I'm working for chess.com, but I'm not involved in all this.
I know.
Chess.com is willing and planning to share information with FIDE, but not directly with Armenia.
Yeah, we are happy to serve as an intermediary and to summarize all the information that will come to us from chess.com and Armenia, since we need the information, this information from both sides to have the full report. And then after we'll have both, we can have a summary report so that everyone would know what happened, what were the things underlying the decision. So we didn't find anything suspicious on a global scale or on the side of chess.com. And at the same time, regulations clearly say that the internet connectivity is sole responsibility of players. So based on that and only on that, the appeal committee didn't have any other opinion or solution rather than to confirm the results of the game that have been announced by the chief arbiter. So that Hayek unfortunately lost to Sarin. And the results state, it was really unfortunate that the team Armenia went out of the competition after this decision, saying that it is unfair to them and they didn't compete in the second match. I was not happy about their decision. Of course, they were not happy about our decision. I thought they could continue giving their spectators the joy of watching the further games, and they had all chances to get the match back and have an Armageddon. And they have a really strong team and they deserved it. But it was their decision. We cannot do anything about it. So coming to India-Russia match, visibly it was the same situation. Just not one game, but two games.
Except that, of course, in the final, the Zoom calls also froze, unlike the quarterfinal.
Exactly. Zoom calls froze. I mean, initially, it looked the same, first few seconds. So two games, Zoom calls froze, and we started getting confirmation from different sources, including chess.com, but also global mass media. And we found that there is a global issue. There is a global outage of internet. And I saw the publication yesterday. It was not during the decision-making time, but yesterday that it caused internet traffic down by 3.5% globally, meaning that in the countries that have been affected directly, it was maybe 35%.
Yeah, it was one of the biggest outages ever.
Or even more. So that means that was 100% probability almost that if six players play, then maybe a couple of games will be affected. What I'm not happy about is that we couldn't get this information before the match. Probably we could postpone it based on the knowledge that there is a global issue and we could play this match thereafter rather than at the time where issues were really big around the world. So that's the lesson we should learn for the future. If you have a very important online event and we have the information that there is a global issue with the internet, we should postpone the competition rather than go ahead with this, having all those risks. The situation was that after receiving the same information, the Indian team decided to appeal. Actually, they had a similar case before at the group stage.
Against Mongolia.
Against Mongolia, losing two games by this, and they didn't appeal that since they didn't have any information that could be caused by a global issue rather than a local one. Actually, after that, they made their infrastructure stronger and they used a special software that allows to use two internet providers simultaneously, making it much safer for them to play. So they didn't appeal that time, but when they saw this kind of information, they decided to appeal. They appealed. The only thing they asked for is not to confirm the results of those two games. They didn't ask for any specific solution like replaying the games or continuing the games from the moment those stopped. They just asked for not confirming their losses, leaving it for the appeal committee or FIDE in general to decide what to do with the situation. I couldn't participate in the meeting of the appeal committee since I have the conflict of interest being Russian. So we had only two members, Michael Khodorkovsky and Sava Stoyashevich, discussing this. And they asked for additional information from chess.com. They have been provided with this information. They didn't have a unanimous decision what to do. They understood.
I have a question about that.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that means there are two conflicting opinions there between Mr. Khodorkovsky and Ms. Stoyashevich.
Sava felt that she doesn't have sufficient information to take a final decision. While Michael had a certain proposal, certainly there was no majority for any of the proposals.
My first question about this: why wasn't there a third person placed there? Why weren't you substituted by someone else so that you have an odd number of people in the committee again?
I would acknowledge that it was a missing part of the regulation, a missing part in our decisions. We didn't make the decision ex ante, and there was no way this kind of decision can be made in the process of decision making. So. Since people will again have many questions about how this person, etc., etc.
Right. So it had to be arranged before. Yeah, but you are acknowledging that in the future you will always need three.
I think we always need reserve members of the appeal committee to always have three. So that was clearly an imperfection in our regulation.
And while we're at the topic of forming an appeals, don't you think an appeals committee should include at least one chess player?
You mean the top chess player, Michael is a good coach anyway, so he.
Sure, but I mean, such big events. Also in history, there's always been a feeling that at least one of the participants should be able to be in the committee as well.
Maybe.
It's
something to think about. Okay. There are plus and minuses. That and chess players are very specific people, I would say, with all respect. And sometimes they have very surprising opinions about going on.
Which could be positive or negative, but yeah.
Yes, but I think when you, we are talking about appeals, and it's not about... and there is no rule to decide on the result of the game based on the positions, when it's only about legal and procedural matters. Well, there is a question mark. But certainly, in this particular case, we could use chess players, and I could even do it, and I will explain to you in a second. Since the appeal committee didn't come to any decision regarding what to do next, well, because they decided that the results cannot stay. That was clear.
Since, yeah, that's another interesting thing. And I also have a question there, actually, because that was actually discussed by an arbiter, Chris Bird, and Grandmaster Peter Hein Nielsen on Twitter. If you have an appeals committee and the appeals committee cannot make a decision, shouldn't you just leave the decision of the chief arbiter standing then? Why can you overrule the chief arbiter without making a decision in the appeals committee?
No. Let me be clear. The appeals committee was okay with two things: not confirming the result, the results claimed by the chief arbiter, and not asking Armenia to pay a fee for the appeal. The thing that was missing, where there was no unanimous decision of the appeal committee, is what to do next.
Aha, right. So they did agree that India's appeal, that the two games were lost by time, should not be declared lost. That's
correct.
What they actually agreed on.
Correct.
Aha. Correct. But then the next stage was what to do.
Yes, since one might say that since we have those two games, unclear, then it is 2.5 against 1.5 and 1.5, and Russia won. But regulations say that you need 3.5 to win the match. So it's not true that Russia won the match two games have not been played, basically, or unfinished.
Right.
So we had to find the solution. So we're at least three possibilities to do that. At least, maybe to proceed, maybe more. So one was to replace those two games, and many people actually proposed that.
Mm-hmm.
For me, a problem with that kind of proposal was both on fairness and technical side. On technical side, internet issues have not been over. Replaying would mean that we should postpone until the next day.
Let me what was the problem with that?
Was no major problem with that,
Normally speaking, you are limited to renting a venue and stuff like that, and people have to catch their planes. But if everybody is at home anyway,
well, first of all, we don't know, since people know the schedule of the Olympiad.
Yes, that's true.
Who knows?
You will be able to find a time within a few days where everybody can be playing.
Yeah, like the candidates tournament. I would not say that's the best situation I have right now with the candidates tournament. When you don't know when and how you're going to do this. Of course, with this kind, it could be easier, but still, you create a gap between the almost the whole competition and the very final final thing that you should have. And it was possible, but I was not sure it is.
But you were all saying it was also, you're not sure it was fair.
Fair. Yes, exactly. And that it comes, now it comes already to your point that maybe you should have chess players in the appeal committee. I strongly felt that Russia should not be put under risk of losing the Olympiad in this particular situation. There was almost no chance that Russia would lose in these two games given the situation. Very likely to lose one, almost impossible to lose another one. So the worst possible result was 3-3 for Russia mm-hmm. and Armageddon in this case. So I would certainly say that Armageddon would be a fair thing rather than playing those two games from the very beginning. Since I didn't feel that it is fair, and I put also myself on the now on the Armenian side, I would say, when they came out of the room, I thought that there is a risk that Russia would go out. And that could be the second disaster over the playoffs. But, for me, okay, for me, the Armenia going out was a real real disaster. I mean, not from the point of view that I dislike the Armenian step. I don't like it, but it's another thing. It's about the reputation of the Olympiad. People going yes. out is a kind of boycott of the official event. Even if the probability of this step from the Russian side was like 20%, whatever. I was not going to take this risk on this of the event.
In the but final. You're saying that you made a lot of assumptions about the possible outcomes of those two games, about the possible stepping out of Russia out of the Olympiad. You made those assumptions, but actually, I think it was Daniel Dubov who shared his surprise that the Russian team was not even contacted. Why didn't you contact the Russian team and ask them, are you willing to play those games again?
That's not true. I was in contact with the Russian Chess Federation. But we were not discussing the solutions. I gave them information about...
So why didn't you ask them simply, are you okay with playing the two games again?
I contacted them at the time of the consideration of the appeals committee. When I was not involved in that, I just informed that this consideration, deliberations are still mm-hmm. going on, and they are considering different options. Of course, the options might include replaying the games. I received an answer.
You couldn't simply ask them again. Are you okay with playing the games again?
What if I would receive an answer that no, we are not going to play?
You can still make the same decision as you did, but then at least you know that.
No, that would put me in the position where I would make this decision under the pressure from the team. I didn't want to have a pressure from any of the teams while making the decision. I wanted to take my own decision. It is my responsibility. If I would get any, and you should understand that on both parts, it was a very emotional situation. So people, could not control fully their emotions as well. And they could take a completely unreasonable emotional decisions and make claims like that. They will not be proud of themselves the day after, but that would happen. I didn't want to put myself in this position to hear those things and to be under pressure. And I didn't want to put them in this position to take decisions under those huge emotions. Of course, there were other options like replaying starting from the positions that the games have been stopped, but most people believe that it is even worse than replaying from the beginning. Since people had time to think about the positions, exactly. People knew how to...
That's not great, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you consider declaring the second match equal and finishing with an Armageddon?
No. No, I know that there is could be such a proposal, but actually nobody proposed it. Even the appeal committee members, I contacted them, of course, to find out what the decision. They said that they considered only the first two options that I just mentioned. And out of those two, they believe replaying games from the beginning is a better one, but they didn't come to the unanimous decision about that, that's why they're not proposing this firmly.
So, how did you, in the end, how did you come to the decision to give the medals, the gold medals, to both teams?
Yes, I'll explain that. I certainly thought that given the situation, Russia, based on the decision of the, as you said, of the chief arbiter, deserves the win, but India doesn't deserve to lose, since it was not their fault that those two games have been lost. So both teams deserve having the gold. That was my logic based on fairness. So from technical perspective, I thought that we cannot continue playing this day. So if we need to postpone, and that is not, I thought at that point, and I had only a few minutes to take the decision, I thought at that point that it's not a good outcome to postpone it to another day. From legal perspective, I thought it's different from the Armenian case, since we have the proof that it is global. So it is a different situation. We should not base our decision on the same logic. And from the fairness perspective, I thought that it would be fair to give gold to both teams. So that was the full logic I used. Once again, I didn't want the situation where one of the teams would just go out of the playing hall.
Right. Yeah. So yeah, you actually already mentioned it before. You didn't like that it was described as a political decision, but at the same time, it is understandable people thought about that, because it's a very it's like a compromise decision. It's a decision that that sort of tries to keep both sides happy in a way. Which is very common in politics. In fact, you've been a politician yourself for many years. And at the same time, in the world of sports, as people are arguing, it's very important that there is a winner. At the end of the day, a sports event needs to have a winner, a clear winner. So, do you agree with that?
I certainly agree with that. Though in some sports we had cases where two winners. In some cases it was due to the technical issues. For instance, in speed sports like swimming or running, at some point the clocks have not been able to identify the marginal differences. So there was a certain degree of precision in the clocks, and so there was no other way rather than to have two winners in some competitions, even in the Olympics. That happened before. I also remember the ice skating competition where the Russian player won the competition, but then was decision to give gold to another player, I think from Canada, since the organizing committee felt that judges have been not fair to the Canadian pair, so they overruled the decision of referees and gave another gold to the Canadian pair. So I would say that this one is similar to what we did, but it was also a scandal, of course. And this is very important, since I remember this case. All spectators around the world, especially spectators from the Soviet Union, where the first pair was. Of course, they thought that it's their victory. Mm-hmm. And they considered that the decision to give another gold, it's probably a nice compromise, but all spectators in the Soviet Union considered our Soviet pair as winners, not the second one. And I strongly believe that in Russia and in many other countries, spectators would consider that Russia won this competition. In India, of course, it's different, they consider that India is champion. Of course, I understand the emotions, but in some tweets, people could be a bit more balanced in terms of saying who are the champions, rather than saying that just one country is the champion. It's not formally true. Again, it's about interpretation. It's about feelings. I'm sure that the Russian team should be proud about winning the Olympiad. and the Russian spectator should be proud about the Russian team winning the Olympiad after winning the world team and European team championships, the third team competitions won in a row by the Russian team. And for India, it's the first gold in the Olympiad, not the same Olympiad, but still very important gold for the Olympiad. They never had it before. People should be proud of their teams. I said it to Russian media actually, since I cannot fully separate my heart and my brain, but I had to do it at that point. So in my heart, of course, Russia won the competition, and I took the decision to give India another gold. So they also the champions. My brain did it, not my heart. But that's the situation. That's how things are done in real life. Fortunately or unfortunately, sometimes one person has to make a decision.
So yeah, let me put you in a hypothetical situation, because of course the same thing could have happened also in Armenia, India. In the quarterfinal, in a final you can make a decision like this, but in a quarterfinal or semifinal, you really have to have one team going to the final. So what if Armenia lost their game because of a cloud flare issue?
And it was not in the first match, but in the second match.
Yes,
right? Since they had the second match, that could affect my decision. And I thought that they have all chances.
Let me put it this way. What if the whole set situation happened in the semifinal?
I think the only way to do it was your proposal to have Armageddon.
Mm-hmm. So then you would have had them play for it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Correct. At least I think so now. Every time there are many factors, but I think that would be a fair decision and at least partially legal, if not completely legal. At least partially legal and fair. So that's...
Or maybe in this case you would have started by trying to replay the two games, ask both teams if they would be happy with that, or you would just go...
But I don't know. Very hard to put myself in an artificial position since...
I understand.
I would certainly prefer in the future not to be a member of the appeal committee.
I was actually thinking about this too, that you are really close to the chess. You really follow it as a chess fan as well, all those events. So at some point I was thinking, aren't you a little bit too much involved as a FIDE president? Shouldn't you maybe take a little bit more distance in those situations, or do you feel it's okay like this?
No, for the final decision making in a case like that, anyway, I would have to decide even without, well, formally, I was not doing appeal committee job in the final, so it was the same thing. But nobody else can decide besides the president if the situation is completely stuck there is no simple solution. But for the appeal committee job, I think you are right. I should be distant in the future.
Okay, just a few things that came on Twitter from especially the players of the Russian team and also the Armenian team. As I said, those two teams were not too happy about everything. For example, Jan Nepomniachtchi tweeted that it was a smart decision to please Indian chess community. We can talk about the chess boom in India a bit later, but he felt that because there's so much attention in India, that this might have influenced your decision.
I discussed this with him for a few hours already. With Nero, so we discuss chess things a lot, almost daily with Jan and with some other players as well. I understand his feelings. I just think he's not right, but he has his own view on that. That's okay. That's okay for me. He was at least doing making those comments in correct way, I would say. Mm. Was no offense here.
Okay, and then Daniel Dubov called the whole decision a disrespect to the Russian team. And Elina Danielian was also very strong, tweeting, for example, shame on FIDE. So it seems there is a little bit of a damage between FIDE, or maybe you and some top players in Russia and some top players in Armenia. Levon Aronian was also not happy and also tweeted about it. Do you feel you need to repair their relationships with the Russian and Armenian top players a little bit?
I had conversations with Daniil, and I think we understood each other. While I strongly disagree with some of his comments and the way he made those comments, I respect him a lot, and I think we have mutual understanding about that. We need to put emotions aside, and we'll continue discussing this thing probably with the whole team, not just with him. But again, we had a conversation, and it's okay. Certainly I would not recommend anyone to make comments like that under emotional pressures. Everyone should calm down before making public statements, and at least discuss things with the second party, with another party, before making those statements.
Right.
I was in contact with Levon Aronian, and of course he's very much disappointed about that, and I understand him. I explained my position to him in detail. Hopefully he understood me, and I strongly believe we have huge mutual respect between two of us. Regarding Kalina, let's leave this for her own responsibility. I don't want to comment on her statements. I don't think that I should go down to this level of discussion.
Okay. And then one last thing. I also found out on Twitter, I think it was Malcolm Payne who suggested this relating to a system in cricket. What do you think maybe for the future of some kind of adjudication system where, for example, the time remaining on the clock combined with a computer assessment of the position can lead to maybe an independent jury deciding games, won, lost, or drawn?
Well, that's not impossible, but I would say it would not be real chess. But it is not impossible. Maybe in some tournaments that would be possible. But again, I think everything should be decided eventually on the board. And what happened this time is not an optimal thing. It's I was choosing between the options that are not good at all.
Yeah.
Almost
all
of them
were not good. Yeah.
Yes, just out of bad choices. So in the future, everything should be decided on the board in all cases where it is possible.
All right. We're almost finishing up. I, except for what we might have already discussed, when you look back, what is the biggest thing you learned from this Olympiad? Something you might want to do differently next time?
Well, we learned that there is a huge interest in this kind of online chess competitions, including of the team nature, not just individual, and people like this stuff. We had a real festival for amateurs, Checkmate Coronavirus Festival, that was also interesting. But this kind of the professional team competition is, of course, very exciting. And I think we should consider options how to structure those online team competitions in the future, whether to continue with Olympiads or do it in some other way. But even
without the coronavirus,
without, not as a substitute to anything, but as a complement to traditional chess events. Somewhere in the middle, sometimes there are some gaps in the schedule, maybe to like spread those events across the long time span throughout the year. We should think about all options that we might have. A second thing we learned is that certainly there is a need to strengthen internet infrastructure all around the world. That would be our first recommendation to the governments, of course, and to investors to concentrate on. But I think people know about this anyway, especially given the pandemic lessons, investments into the physical infrastructure of internet will increase in the nearest future. Anti-cheating is also one of the lessons we are improving, but we are far from the solution, far from the optimal situation. I addressed the chess community in August with some ideas. So we are collecting ideas now from our colleagues, from our friends, from our chess family, and we will consider this these options at the next FIDE Council meeting. So that's really, really important. Mm-hmm. We already discussed that we need to explore those innovations in more detail, whether to have mixed teams in the future for some competitions, but not for all. We should have also separate ones, but maybe for some competitions it is reasonable. We should explore different ways of tie breaks, including blitz games before Armageddon. That's certainly possible. We should think in particular about the World Team Championships. The Online Olympiad is the event for all teams. World Team Championships is only for top teams. So we need to think how to structure this event based on the experience we had now at the Online Olympiad.
Okay. Yeah. And finally, I think one of the very positive effects of this Olympiad has been that the incredible attention it got in India, also in some other countries, but India stood out on the last day where Chess Olympiad hashtag was trending topic number two in the country, and even the Prime Minister was tweeting about it. So in that sense, I assume we can look back at a successful tournament, right?
Yeah, it is. I think it was a success. And when China was still in the tournament, the interest in China was also huge, of course. They lost both to India in the last round of the group stage, and then they lost to Ukraine in the playoffs. But China is also a huge market, I would say, for FIDE, as some other countries as well. In Russia, like also the tsunami of tweets and also congratulations from the president of Russia to the Russian team as well, published yesterday.
Okay.
But in India, yes, it's quite special. I'm happy that they have a young generation that is playing very high quality level. Probably Russia and India are now at the top of the youngsters competitions. There are some other countries as well, like Iran and China, of course, and others. But India and Russia are clearly growing chess nations with the largest number of active chess players. So the top two countries in terms of number of active chess players right now. The first thought I had yesterday is that we should not replay the final, but maybe we should have the match between India and Russia in the nearest future. Kind of champion series or something like that. Why not? That would create huge interest in the chess community, both in Russia and India, and could support the boom that has been created by this online chess Olympiad, but has much deeper foundations in the history, of course, as India is a mother of chess, and Russia has had one of the best traditional chess schools. So why not?
Yeah, sounds like an interesting idea, yeah. Especially if we may include Armenia, then everybody will be happy. All right. Arkady, thank you very much for being here and for answering all questions.
Yes, thank you for this
interview. And good luck with all the future events that are going to happen.
Yes, for the future, we are thinking about what to do this year. The most important things is to complete the candidates tournament, of course, and women Grand Prix as well.
Are you still confident it might happen this year?
Yeah, I think we can have it in November or early December. Why not?
Okay.
Candidates, women Grand Prix, and we will think about some format of the World Draft and Blitz, but we, of course, we are not sure yet. When we are talking about online, one of the thinking is about World Bullet. So that's an idea we are exploring now.
Sounds exciting. Thanks again, and until next time.
Yeah, thank you.